kindness. Ebby, as I understand it, Ebby and Bill were good friends growing up and what have you, okay? And Ebby was a real bad drinker, you know, real heavy alcoholic and everything. And I guess towards the end, the story is that Ebby's driving down the road and he goes off the road and he plows his car right into somebody's house and ends up in the kitchen, you know. And he looks up, the lady of the house is standing there, and he says, "Hi, can I have a cup of coffee?" You know, and as a result of that, I guess the police came, you know, getting ready to lock this guy up. Now, I mentioned to you Roland Hazard a little while ago. Roland Hazard is another fellow that we'll start reading about here in Chapter 2. And Roland came from a very wealthy family. And Roland had a lot of money at his disposal. But Roland also was an alcoholic. And Roland went to see lots of different doctors trying to beat this thing. And none of the doctors were able to help him. Okay, Roland ended up involved with a group known as the Oxford Groups. And as I understand them, they were sort of a Christian fundamentalist group that wanted to get back to the way Christianity was years ago. Okay, and one of their precepts was that they went out and helped other people. Okay, so Roland got involved with the Oxford Groups. And it was Roland and another man who appeared in court that we just read here. And said to the judge, when the judge was going to lock Ebby up, this is what Bill had heard, he'd been committed, right? Roland showed up and says, "Hey, Judge, how about you, we've got this program going, how about you release him into our custody?" And so the judge says, "Okay, I'll release him." So Ebby went with Roland Hazard and started working with Roland and the Oxford Group's program. And as a result, Ebby got sober for a little bit, okay? You know. Going back here, he says, "That was 2 months ago and the result was self-evident. It worked. He had come to pass his experience along to me, if I cared to have it." All right? And I underline a word "if" in my book because I told you people before, I know this book uses lots of big words in different places, all right? And we read a couple of them tonight, you know, and more about alcoholism. They talk about incomprehensible demoralization. You know, I don't even know how many syllables that is. I don't think I have enough fingers to count them all. But there's some real big words in here. And I think two of the biggest words that they have in here are "if" and "and." These are conditional statements, all right, that if you do this, that will happen. If you don't do it, it's not going to happen. You know, so Bill is now saying Ebby has come to pass along his experience to him if Bill's interested in it. If Bill's not interested in it, you know, waste of time. Bill goes on here, he says, "I was shocked but interested. Certainly I was interested. I had to be, for I was hopeless." All right. Again, Bill's just, you know, I showed you where he went through first time. He's admitting that thing again. He's hopeless. He's helpless. He doesn't know where to go. He doesn't know what to do. He goes on here. He says, Ebby, talked for hours. Childhood memories rose before me. I could almost hear the sound of the preacher's voice as I sat on still Sundays, way over there on the hillside. Okay, right now, this is, Bill is reminiscing, going back into his own life and starting to remember all the things that he was told about religion. All right, and he's getting a little riled up. The hair on his neck is standing up here. Okay, he's remembering all the bad things and why he got away from some of this stuff. All right, because Ebby has just told him, "I got religion, and this is the solution." And Bill said, "Oh shit, do I have to go through this again? I didn't like it the last time. I don't want to do this stuff." You know, he says, "Childhood memories rose before me. I could almost hear the sound of the preacher's voice as I sat on still Sundays, way over there on the hillside. There was that Prophet Temperance pledge I never signed." Right? They asked him to sign up, say never drink again. That Bill had nothing to do with that. "My grandfather's good-natured contempt of some church folk in their doing." All right. "His insistence that the spheres really had their music, but his denial of the preacher's right to tell him how he must listen. His fearlessness as he spoke of these things just before he died." Okay, Bill is remembering his grandfather and how his grandfather was saying, look at those people. They say one thing in church on Sunday, and out here they do just the opposite, you know. And Bill is looking at this, and this is all coming back. He says, "These recollections welled up from the past. They made me swallow hard. That wartime day in old Winchester Cathedral came back." You know, so he's remembering back when he was standing in Winchester Cathedral looking at that tombstone, you know, that talked about that Hampshire Grenadier. He says, "I had always believed in a power greater than myself. I had often pondered these things. I was not an atheist. Few people really are. For that means blind faith in the strange proposition that this universe originated in a cipher and aimlessly rushes nowhere. My intellectual heroes, the chemists, the astronomers, even the evolutionists, suggested vast laws and forces at work. Despite contrary indications, I had little doubt that a mighty purpose and rhythm underlie all. How could there be so much of precise and immutable law and no intelligence? I simply had to believe in a spirit of the universe who knew neither time nor limitation. But that was as far as I had gone. Okay, so Bill believes that there is something out there, all right? If something had to put this whole stuff, this whole universe together and make it work. But that's as far as he's willing to go right there, all right? But he's beginning to have a little faith come through, all right? Abby's describing the stuff and he's thinking about it, you know. Bill says, with ministers in the world's religions, I parted right there. When they talked of a God personal to me, who was love, superhuman strength and direction, I became irritated and my mind snapped shut against such a theory. Bang, snap shut, like that. He doesn't want to hear nothing else. Don't tell me no more. My mind's made up. Don't confuse me with the facts. All right? That's it. He's not going to listen. You know, he goes on the next page here. He says, to Christ, I conceded the certainty of a great man, not too closely followed by those who claimed him. Okay? He's saying, Christ was good, but all those people that come along and use Christ in their name and say, I'm just like him, they're full of bullshit. You know? look at what they're doing out there, you know? All right, he says, again, referring to Christ, his moral teaching most excellent. For myself, I had adopted those parts which seemed convenient and not too difficult. The rest I disregarded. Okay? And that's actually what I did in those first 8 years in this program. I came in here, I listened to you people, went to meetings, read some books, and the stuff that seemed convenient, I wanted to do. It was easy. All right? But the other stuff that was too difficult, I just disregarded it. You know, I don't need that stuff. As a result, I didn't get sober. He says, the wars which had been fought, the burnings and chicanery that religious dispute had facilitated, made me sick. I honestly doubted whether, on balance, the religions of mankind had done any good. Judging from what I had seen in Europe and since, the power of God in human affairs was negligible. The brotherhood of man, a grim jest. If there was a devil, he seemed to be the boss universal, and he certainly had me. But my friend sat before me, and he made the point-blank declaration that God had done for him what he could not do for himself. God had done for him what he could not do for himself. I mean, you talk to anybody that's spent any time in this program, has worked these steps, they're going to tell you the exact same thing. They're going to come in and tell you, go to these speaker meetings and listen for this. They're going to come in and tell you, listen, I was like you. I could not stop drinking. My life was going right down the tubes. I got involved in this program. Don't know how it happened. I worked the steps. The steps brought me in touch with God, and God has done for me what I could not do for myself. He goes on. He says, referring to what Ebby told, his human will had failed. Doctors had pronounced him incurable. Society was about to lock him up. Like myself, he had admitted complete defeat. All right, so Bill is starting to recognize, Ebby's telling Bill what had gone on. And Bill is starting to identify with Ebby's story here. Bill knows how Ebby drank. Bill knows what Ebby was like. And he said, like myself, he admitted complete defeat. So, you know, they're identifying with one another. And Bill's starting to think, well, maybe, you know, if this had worked for Ebby, maybe there's something to this.